Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Here we are, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. Talking with Brendan McGeehan today on the show, this week on the show, right now on the show. Brendan McGeehan, he's a producer and engineer, bassist, very, very interesting dude. I've known of him for a little bit. And it was great to go talk to him. I went up to Elm Street Studios up in Conshohocken. Always love going to studios. I always love talking to producers in their home studios. One, I find that they are very comfortable there. And also, I just like seeing rooms. I just like seeing studios. I'd never seen Elm Street before. So it was win-win for me right there. We'll talk more about Brendan and his new project, his solo project called Peace Fortress, and the new record that's coming out with that. We'll talk about all of that in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly recommend you check out 25oclockpod.com. That's where you go, out there on the internet for all your 25 o'clock things. Everything's there. You can get all the episodes. They're all available for streaming and for downloading. You can sign up for the mailing list. I send out an email every time there's a new episode. I'll let you know what's going on. You can hook up with us on the socials. We're on Instagram. We're on TikTok. We're around. We're out there. And of course, you check out the Friends and Neighbors page. I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like an artist, you like what you hear, and you want to be able to support them and sign up for their mailing list and find out when they're playing and buy their records and do all that, you can do that via the Friends and Neighbors page. I've made it so very easy for you. And of course, be sure to check out our Patreon for the show, patreon.com/25oclockpod. As I've said many times, making a Philadelphia music podcast does not cost all the money or even a ton of money, but it does cost an amount of money. And I want to keep this show free for as long as humanly possible. I think we've been doing a pretty good run so far, almost 10 years, over 300 episodes. It's all free. And all I'm asking for out there is that if you really get something out of this show, and I know a lot of people do because people tell me about it, and it always makes me happy and humble and kind of, oh, pshaw, when people tell me how much they dig the show. But if you like it and you wanted to know a way to support it outside of just listening to it and telling your friends about it, patreon.com/25oclockpod. We have one level of support, and every little bit helps. So If you're ever thinking about that, go to patreon.com/25oclockpod and become a supporter of the podcast. Help keep it free for all the good people out there in the world. Yes. I hope everyone enjoyed the playlist episodes that have come out over the last couple of weeks. I always have a good time making them. A lot of great music. 20 brand new songs between those two episodes from Philadelphia artists. I hope you enjoyed that. I've already gotten some great feedback on that. Like I said, they're always fun to put together. I always like including as many people as possible. And I like that it turns a lot of people on to music that they wouldn't have heard of otherwise. So thank you all for the kind words of that. I will be off all of August. We've done this in previous years. I pretty much take all of the month of August off. Now that doesn't mean that I ain't doing nothing. I'm typically recording episodes and kind of figuring out what the rest of the year is going to look like. And I'll be back first week of September for fall, right around Labor Day. And we're going to get ready for fall. Lots of cool stuff happening. Exponential Music Fest, Philly Music Fest, and lots of other stuff. It's also our 10-year anniversary this fall as well. 10 years of the podcast. I started it in fall of 2014, and here we are, fall of 2024, and no one is more surprised by this than I am, that the show has lasted 10 years, over 300 episodes, and so I've got some ideas, some stuff in store for that as well. So, we'll take a little break in August, be back in September, ready to go. Let's talk about Brendan McGeehan. Like I said, he's a producer and engineer, bassist. Works at Elm Street Studios. It's Robbie Hyman of the Hooters. That's his studio. I first heard of Brendan when I interviewed Aaron Parnell Brown for his band, The Right Fiction. Brendan is part of that, plays bass, and is the producer of those records, also with Freddie Berman. And I really, really loved those records. I loved how it all hung together. I loved the production. I loved the bass on it. So as you hear, I say this in conversation with Brendan. After hearing all that, I thought, like, oh, well, I hope someday I get to meet this guy. And I did. But Brendan has been part of tons and tons of records that they have come through Philadelphia and beyond. He's worked all over the country. But he has a new record out under his own project. It's a solo project for him. It's an instrumental record under the name Peace Fortress. The record is called New Moon. It's out July 18th, which is also the day of the record release show at the Falzer Club. July 18th, 7:30 p.m., the Falzer Club up at 3721 Midvale Avenue in Philadelphia. His live band consists of him, Logan Roth, Adrian Harpham, and my boy Will Brown. We talk about all these people in the episode coming forward. They'll also be sharing the stage that night with Slowy and the Boats and SMC Quintet. Go to falzerclub.com or just go to the show notes of this episode as well. I'll throw ticket information in there. Be sure to go to brendanmcgeehan.com, not only for information about Peace Fortress, but all the other cool stuff that he's worked on. It's a lot of things. So yeah, why don't we roll into it? Like I said, I went up to Elm Street Studios in Conshohocken and sat and got to hang out and talk with Brendan. Big ups to his intern who recorded the whole thing, whose name I forgot, and I should have written it down. I don't know why I didn't write it down. That's not cool of me. Brendan's awesome intern was the guy who recorded all this for us. So thank you so much. But let's get into it. Let's get into my conversation with Brendan McGeehan here on 25 O'Clock.
No, you grew up in Maryland?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Eastern Shore. So what, like, some Marylanders would not consider real Maryland. Like,
yeah, I guess. Yeah, so that's the shore that kind of borders over towards, that's like Chesapeake, right?
Yeah, like kind of even more so, like more of the Atlantic Ocean side.
Oh, okay. Like, that's right, yeah. You do, there is a part of you that does border the ocean.
Yeah.
So every Maryland place I ever go to that always wants to dine out a you know, pun intended, on like, oh, it's the seafood capital. I'm like, you guys don't share as much coastline as you think you do.
Yeah. It's the area is called like Delmarva because you've got a little bit of Delaware, a little bit of Maryland, a little bit of Virginia.
Yeah.
Right there.
No, I know that part. I mean, it's all gorgeous there. I've had great time down in the Chesapeake, like going, I did a lot of kayaking there for a few years.
Yeah. I was just talking to a friend of mine earlier today about that because that's one of my favorite things to do growing up was going to Assateague Island and kayaking.
Oh man, Assateague is the best.
Yeah,
I love that the horses own that joint.
Yeah.
Those are some terrifying ponies.
Yeah, you don't mess with them.
No, they like, I don't know, I've gone hiking down there too. Well, hiking, I mean, you can't really, it's not a hike down there, it's just a really, really punishing walk.
Sure, that's a good way to put it. Yeah, it could be brutal, and depending on the green-headed fly season, it could be really terrible.
It is beautiful down there. Yeah, like Ocean City and like mm-hmm. all that.
Yeah. Yeah, I grew up just outside of Ocean City.
Oh, cool. So, what was the deal growing up? Like, was there a lot of music in the house? Are you the weirdo?
Yeah, I think so. Well, there was music in the house. No one in my immediate family or extended family, as far as I know, are musicians. A lot of very musical people, but both of my parents listened to a lot of music and my sister listened to a lot of music, so there was always music on.
Are you younger?
I'm the youngest, yeah. I'm one of two.
Gotcha. How much older is your sister?
Year and a half.
Okay, so you're pretty close mm-hmm. in there, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, so you're growing up and they're listening, well, like what do they listen to? What's in the house growing up?
So my dad was a huge James Brown fan, huge blues fan, B.B. King, and goes from there. And then my mother was big into Springsteen, big into what I guess we would call classic rock.
Yeah.
And there was some crossover there. And then my sister has gone through all sorts of phases in her listening, but we were on the same page for a lot of stuff. And she's cool. She's got some good taste.
Yeah. Well, that's good. It's good to have someone in the house showing you, even just a little older. I'm the oldest of three, so there's a lot of passing down of records and tapes and stuff like that. And stuff that I later learned that like my brother would tell me, he's like, oh, that changed my life. And I was like, I don't even remember giving that to you. But like, that's kind of how the story goes sometimes, is that if you're the giver, it's nothing to you, but it's like when you get it.
You never know the effect you have for something like that.
Yeah. I mean, I know the stuff that got dropped on me. Like what got dropped on you, like when you were, you know, kind of in that teenage period?
I mean, the biggest thing for me was there was this kid in middle school who was playing guitar in jazz band. I played trumpet. He couldn't read music at all, but he could play his ass off. And so that's how he got into jazz band. And he was obsessed with Jimi Hendrix. And okay. So he was just feeding me stuff. And the first time I heard All on the Watchtower, everything changed.
Yeah.
It was incredible. And I later learned that that was Jimmy on bass, but I was so attracted to the bass line of that, believe it or not, even though there's such incredible guitar work.
Well, yeah, but that's the fun thing about so much of Hendrix's stuff, regardless of the band. Like, he always put himself, either he played it himself, which I didn't actually know that was him playing it on that track, or he put himself with people who were insane, like just insane bassists. And like, I always think of like learning like the bass part to like Fire or something like that, like when I was a teenager, and just being like, oh, this is, we're bobbing and weaving right here. Yeah. That was, when did the bass come in?
So shortly after that, once I started hanging out with this guy, and then there was a drummer friend as well. And so the two of them would like jam before and after class. And I was just like, I want to be a part of that. And they needed a bass player. And I just happened to like gravitate towards bass lines. So my mom took me to, we had one record shop in town and they had one bass guitar. They carried like a couple of instruments, even though they sold records. So I got that bass.
What was it?
It was a P bass knockoff.
Yep.
Like an Aria knock, P bass Sunburst. And I was obsessed. Like every day after school, I would come home and play it, and I had no technique. I had no idea what I was doing. I remember I played only with my thumb, and I had this giant callus or just giant blister. But
not in the popping way. You were just plucking everything
with my thumb because I had no idea.
Almost a poorly constructed James Jamerson style or something like that, but just with your thumb instead of your index finger.
Poorly constructed everything.
Yeah.
I knew nothing. I just loved it.
I started on a pick on bass because I played guitar, and it was just one day I was the odd man out in a band, and I was like, oh, I guess I'll play this thing. And so I went to pick, which is cool because I became a Paul McCartney guy anyway. So once I learned that, but yeah, I still can't do fingerstyle for very long.
Mm.
I can record it. If you let me take a break somewhere after like take three, like I'm
nice.
Yeah. So you're in there like basically banging your thumb on a bass. You like playing to records and stuff like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And then jamming with friends. And then at some point, like kind of formally joined my first band, which was more of like a punk thing in high school. And then just started to branch out from there and just played with as many people as I could. And being a bass player, you're kind of, there's always a spot for you because nobody wants to play bass.
Yeah, no, that was something I learned early on too.
Right.
Because even like for years, I think I was, I don't think until I was like 30 that like I embraced like, okay, I can play this thing and I'm going to actually not hide that from anybody.
Yeah.
Because if you tell people you play bass, people are just like, cool, we know what you're doing. I'm like, okay. And then like somewhere in there, like, I don't know where you come in, like in the great bassists of rock, but for me it's like it was McCartney, John Entwistle, and then later like Peter Hook from New Order, and just realizing I'm like, oh, you can be incredibly melodic on this somewhat what you would think of as a tonally limited instrument.
You know, it's the bridge between the drummer and the guitar and the keyboards.
I call it the liaison. I said it's the rhythm melody liaison.
I love that.
You have to have one foot in each camp, and you can't go too far to one side. You can't be a strictly melodic bass player, and I don't think you can be a strictly rhythmic bass player either. You have to sit in the middle. Yeah. And then somewhere in high school I heard Vic Wooten for the first time, and I was just like, oh, I didn't know you could do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For me, it was like Marcus Miller once I heard him, and that was like, I went to see him once and it was like, yeah, I didn't know you could do that.
Yeah.
And I tried that for a while. Like, had that phase of trying to chase that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Les Claypool too was one for me where I was just like, I don't think I didn't know you could do that. And I don't believe anyone else should do that.
Yeah. And no one else can. Yeah. Turns out.
Yeah. And then like later I got like Phil Lesh and Mike Gordon and all that. Again, two bass players who I always say, I'm like, they're your worst Magnetic Norths. Like, do not, like, learn, take it in, do not follow them. you cannot.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but it never comes off that way.
No, that's the wild thing about him. Him, Phil Lesh too, and I think about like John Entwistle and like just how fast he played and just so much melody in there, and you realize like, oh. But if you're in like a power trio, guitar, bass, drums, like the bass can really, you can either hold down that end or you can go walk around.
I love that freedom. And that's kind of what I was doing early on for me. I was playing in a couple of trios. And so I think that kind of got ingrained early on. And then just listening to players that were fearless like that and would play a lot of notes and take risks and hop on melodies and then support things. Yeah. It's just, there's so many possibilities.
So where does like, I don't know, where you said Marcus Miller, but like, so where do you have like a fascination with jazz even at a young age?
So for me, it was like...
You said you were in jazz band at school, but you were playing trumpet.
Yeah, that was my first instrument. And then I got turned on to Hendrix. And then from Hendrix, that led to Zappa.
Yeah.
And then Zappa kind of led to Miles.
Yeah.
And then things started to really branch out. And,
sort of a dangerous slope right there that you're on.
Oh, man. And still chasing, still on it.
Especially the Zappa stuff. And when you're a kid, too, like or like a teenager, I'm just like... A lot of that stuff maybe isn't musically designed for you, but like, you know, from a humor standpoint, very much designed for you as a teenager. Yeah. And then you get into Electric Miles where it's like, wow, there's nothing funny going on here at all.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Or everything funny, depending on how you look at it.
Yeah. No, it's true. It's true. I guess it depends on how he was looking at it on various days.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's everything kind of branched out. And I think... jazz for me became something that I was always interested in. I would never consider myself a jazz musician, but it's, I'm like jazz adjacent maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, you've played on enough stuff that you can hang. And I've at least for me with bass is, I don't know if you think about it like this way. I hope you don't, where I said like, well, bass is the instrument I can bullshit the best on. Like, but it is like, I can sit and hang on bass so much, because guitar I'm just like, well, there's so many things I could do. At least with bass, like, I don't know, I already have a little bit of a limitation right there just with the nature of the instrument, and you can decide to be like, oh, if I want to play simple, I'll hang out back with the drummer, and if I want to do something interesting, then I'll step forward. But yeah, to me, it's the instrument that I can be the least prepared,
I see.
Or like have the least amount of, and sometimes it's fun, like sometimes you just sit in and be like, okay, I guess I'll figure this out.
Yeah. It's all about just inhabiting a role, I think, you know, and like, that's kind of where my studio brain comes into is what is needed. And so let's play that. It doesn't even necessarily have to be thought of as genres or styles or technique. It's just, what are you hearing, and explore that. And who knows where it lands? That's not really for me to say.
Were you doing like recording when you were younger too? Did that come later?
Yeah, I got into it in high school from playing in bands. And I remember there was a key moment for me. We were this like punk band I was in. We were doing a demo at like some dude's house studio. And I remember plugging in my bass, and he was this dude who was like, he was, you know, let us know how great he was before recording us and how.
That's good. That's always important.
Yeah. Awful we were.
I know you do the same here. Like, just anyone that comes in is like, everyone, I just want to let you know how great I
just
am.
Just knock them right down. And so I remember hearing my bass and just hating the sound of it. And I was like, and I tried to voice that. I was like, I don't think it sounds very good, but I didn't have any of the language to try to say why or how or anything. And I think from then on, I was like, well, why don't we try to do this? Why don't we figure it out? Because this guy wasn't fun to work with and it didn't sound very good. So what are we doing?
Yeah.
So started experimenting with recording at home. It was like Cool Edit Pro, I think was the software that I got from a radio station I was an intern for.
I used that in college. That was in some of the media labs. That and like SoundForge and like early, like Cool Edit was like the one that had multi-track in it.
Yep.
Like you could start stacking things up on it. Yeah. I remember, I don't know how much older I am than you. I think a couple of years, I taught that as an undergrad as well, like Cool Edit Pro.
Nice.
I think I'm one of the last generations too, that actually I learned to splice tape simply so I could teach it.
Yeah.
We certainly weren't recording like that, but the program was just like, I don't know, teach them how to edit a script like on tape. So I don't know if I could still do it. Probably not. Maybe it would come back.
It may. Yeah. I mean, as we say around here, you're better off.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? I've never harbored any. I like tape. I like hearing it. I like watching people who know what to do with it, do stuff with it. I have no aspirations to mess with tape, unless it's like a Tascam, like 4-track cassette recorder, and then I'm all over that.
Sure. Oh yeah, I had one of those too, and that was early on for me. I had like the light blue one.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
was so fun. And I remember specifically talking about the sound of the bass, plugging right into that thing and being like, oh, the bass sounds incredible through this thing. I don't know why.
DI moments are the best. We're just like, what's amp? No, look at this.
Yeah, let's do that.
And it just, because everything breaks up like so evenly, because mm-hmm. you're just right in signal.
And now there's like, this company that makes like a Tascam Portastudio emulator.
Oh, good.
You know, because
that's
the sound.
You can still get those things on eBay for $5, yeah, probably.
They're around. They're around. And we've used them. We actually used one on the last Hooters record. They had these old tapes and they recorded a lot of these old demos from 20 years ago on a Tascam Portastudio, and we transferred them and used them, some of the stuff on the record.
Cool.
Yeah, it was pretty neat.
The thing you're quote unquote not supposed to do.
You know, it's like the more we do this stuff, the more you realize that there are no rules.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's fun too that they still had it and that you can still put your hands on it. Because some of that like real proprietal hard disk stuff from that era is gone. Like if you have these weird file formats, you're just like, nope.
Oh, sure. Yeah, good luck. You know, and it's this place is great in that we have a lot of those machines still here in decent working order. So occasionally we'll do some transfers. Even talking about tape, we did one the other day, transferred some stuff, and that's fun to do. I love tape, but the funny thing is like I didn't come up using tape.
Yeah, I barely did, so yeah.
Right? And then if you talk to any old head engineers, they're like, I would never go back to tape.
No,
you know, the people that came up having to deal with it.
It's like cinematographers are just like, we're never going back to film.
Right.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, we know what's better and easier. Let's do that thing. So like people who didn't grow up using tape, we just romanticize it. Yeah.
It's fun. I get it. Like, I understand the Jack Whites of the world who just love to chase the old stuff. I think it's fun. I mean, I think stuff on film looks great.
It does.
And I think photos on film look great. I think Polaroids look cool. Like, that's a very specific thing. But yeah, overall, it's like, if it's the difference, if it's the hurdle between doing it or not doing it, then I'm like, screw it. Like,
yeah,
get it out of here.
I mean, it, at a point, it becomes prohibitive for time and for cost.
Oh, yeah.
That's a whole thing. But, you know, for me, it always comes back to what's the best tool.
Yeah.
Because I've definitely done head-to-head stuff here with printing stuff to tape and then using plugins and seeing which sounds better, and the tape has won every time.
Yeah,
but it's not always the best tool. But one of the interesting things that I like about it is how it informs the creative process, because you commit to things, you have mm-hmm. to make decisions, and if you're recording completely digitally, you don't have to make decisions until, you know, the end, essentially.
Or at all.
Or
at all,
yeah.
No, that is true. And I've always tried to approach digital recording, even just in demoing, as like, I try and put myself back in 4-track brain. Okay, you have this much room to mess around in, but you're not going to, I always think I'm like you're not going to Brian Wilson this thing, though. Like, you're just, you don't, that's not what this part of the process is for. And even when I get in the studio, too, I'm always just like, in the end, if you can't like get out there and just knock it out, like if you had to, like gun to your head, you're just like, well, okay, we have to just do it that way. Then I'm like, then I don't know, maybe you're just belaboring the whole situation.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, there's just so many ways to do it.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
And that's kind of part of what is cool about doing this stuff and making records, is just finding a new path every time and figuring out new ways to do the same thing, kind of.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because in the end, we're all just, I joke bitterly sometimes, I said, in the end, we're all just making music to people listen to in earbuds, so you know, it's yeah. I was like, so was, yeah, when you do start to go down the rabbit hole of tape and preamps and Neve consoles and all that, I'm like, they're just sticking it in their ears on the treadmill, like let's not, like, and I think most Apple earbuds and whatever are some of the worst sounding things in the world,
unfortunately. Yeah,
yeah. Well, but anyway, but so, so you go on, did you go to school for music? Did you go for music or for recording?
Kind of both. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The program I was in, it was part of the recording department was part of the music department.
Yeah.
So it was a music
degree.
That was
normal back then. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you had to do all the things that like a music ed major would do the auditions and take a lot of the same core classes, which I really liked because, like I mentioned, I had no musical training.
Yeah. You had juries and stuff like that.
Yeah. I had to do a recital and all the formal things. It wasn't like a conservatory, but it was a nice music program. And then they had this cool recording program that was like a concentration.
So you leaned into that as well.
Yeah. And it was like a small school, which I loved, because I kind of assumed that, I looked at going to some of the bigger programs, the more well-known ones, but I was like, I don't know if there's a lot of people there studying this stuff. I don't know if you can get studio time.
Yeah, no, that's a very practical way of thinking about it. It's like, if there's less of us, we could probably hang out here longer.
And we did. I mean, I went in as soon as I could and was like living in the studio.
Where'd you go?
So it was Lebanon Valley College.
Okay.
Out by like Hershey and Harrisburg.
Yeah.
And
out there in Illinois, nothing to do anyway.
So. Yeah. I mean, also that, it's like, let's make music, and quickly got hooked up with some like-minded friends and playing in bands. And then we were like making our own records in the studio. I was like bringing in friends' bands, which is so not allowed.
Yeah.
You know, and just learning everything. And it was like, that was the time to do it. And then as like a writer, I had access to all these musicians who were just game to come into the studio and try to play things that I was working on and writing.
Oh, like, so you were studying composition a little bit too? Or?
I never studied composition, but I was always interested in it. I never felt like I was good enough to study composition, but I liked writing, and I felt cool to like ask people to play some things that I was writing. And I was dabbling in film scoring at the time, so it's kind of doing that in parallel with playing in bands.
Well, I wanted to ask about that too. Like, was that something you were interested in even as a young person? Like, did soundtracks and scores kind of like jump out to you?
Yeah, they always did. It was always something that I thought was just really neat, mm-hmm. and part of the experience of watching a film. So I love doing that. And funny enough, the same first punk band, there was three of us. One of the guys was an actor. One of the guys was a photographer. And I was really into music, like writing music. And so we did like some short films together. We were sort of cool. Like a crew.
Yeah.
And we made a few things. And again, they were terrible and we didn't know what we were doing. But we learned a lot. And each of us like did kind of pursue those paths and kept going.
Are you still in touch with those guys?
Yeah. I just was texting with one of them this morning. We were talking about maybe trying to meet up to go to a show in New York in a few months.
Oh, cool. So. Yeah, no, that is something too that I found, because there are people from that time in my life too that I'm still, and meet up with in the same manner right there, where I'm just like, hey, I'm coming through your town, and I think, hey, you want to go see this band or, you know, whatever, because it's still a thing that we can center on. I think those are incredibly long-lasting relationships, partially because of who we are, and also just because I think when you make things together, like, unsupervised at that age, it becomes very clear, like, who you want to do it with.
Yeah. It's such a intense process.
And you do, and like you said, you have no idea what you're doing. You're constantly frustrated that everything you're doing looks like shit.
Yeah.
Or sounds like shit. You're like, why isn't this as good as... It's like we said, when you first heard the bass, like, you probably thought going to that recording studio, it's like, awesome, man, we're going to sound good. And I had those same moments, too, going into rooms with people who... You know, we were high school kids who cobbled together, you know, $200 or whatever to like make a record, and they were just going to get us in and out. Like, they didn't really care. And you walk away from that feeling, not like rooked, but you're just like, oh, that wasn't great. And for the same reasons I started pursuing, like, okay, if it's going to not sound great anyway, how about it not sounds great for free?
Right. Yeah. Why don't I try to do this?
Yeah. Yeah. And then through that, you find creativity, and then you realize, like, I don't know. And then you like learn like one trick. And you're just like, oh, and then just boom, there you go. And the people that you do that with, like, I don't know, that's a bond to cement right there. It's like,
completely.
Hey, remember when we figured out how to make a record that didn't sound like crap or sounded like crap in the way that we wanted it to.
Right.
So your school, you're recording everyone, you're studying music, you're doing all the thing. And then when you get out, like, what was the idea? Did you just kind of start studio hopping off the bat?
I was playing in a couple of bands, and most of those bands were based in Philly, members of the bands. And so that's kind of what drew me here. And I had a very naive thought early on, because I thought that I could never make it as a performer. So why don't I pursue the studio thing? And like, I can do that as like a day gig and then perform on the nights and weekends, not knowing that being an engineer and producer is a full-time thing.
Counterintuitive to what you're doing.
Yeah, like, that is a lifelong pursuit.
Doesn't pay any better sometimes.
And the hours overlap. So yeah, it's so it's kind of like two paths in a way. So I was doing that, and then I came to Philly, and I was working at a studio for a bit and trying to do that, but also trying to like to be in bands and make that work.
Yeah.
And then at one point that got to like kind of a burnout area, and then I decided to really focus on the studio aspect of my life. Always wanted to perform, and I am, but this has kind of taken over as a main, you know, central part of what I do now.
Yeah, you've worked out of so many different rooms too, and something I'm always curious, because I've been in a lot of different rooms. There's, you know, there's the big rooms, the quote unquote famous rooms. I know you've worked out of Ocean Way out in Nashville, mm-hmm. and various other spots. The bunker too, which is I know it's a legendary. Whether or not people would count that as like a big famous room, I think it's a pretty legendary room.
It's yeah, incredible room.
But like, have you found anything that kind of runs the same regardless of like big room, small room, famous room, unheard of room, you know?
Sure.
Someone's C room as opposed to like, you know, the main room.
Right. Yes and no. You know, one thing that I love about studios is like, this is as close as I get to like a sacred space. Mm-hmm. And I think that every studio has a very unique energy to it. And I love that. But there's, within every studio, there are commonalities. There's always something that doesn't work quite well. There's always something that like, oh, you need to know, you have to do it this way. Sometimes there's a dozen of those
yeah.
things that are like less than intuitive.
If you don't do it that way, it doesn't work. Or yeah. the lights go out.
Right. There's always that. But maybe the most common thing is just the quiet of it is so beautiful. And I forget that. I forget that most people have never experienced being in a studio or sitting in on a session.
Oh, true. Yeah.
And it's such a cool thing. And just this quiet nature, like it's its own ecosystem. You know, when I'm working here long days and it's the wintertime, I forget you walk out, maybe it's snowing or maybe there's been a huge weather event and we would have no idea.
Yeah. Yeah. You've made yourself this little bubble in mm-hmm. here to live in. Yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah. And you're all in here just buzzing away at like whatever the idea is, wherever the idea takes you. And then, yeah. And then you go outside and you're just like, oh, 6 inches of snow fallen or right. something like that. Or, oh, it's nighttime now.
Yeah. Or these days.
Or it's morning now.
It could be. Yeah. Walk out and it's like vampire mode. The sun is like beating down and you're like, wow, okay. I need some sunlight right
yeah,
now.
Yeah. 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 It's interesting being down here too, because you just kind of like, it's barely perceptible where we are right here. We're in the middle right. of a neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
But you could still just sort of exist in here and do the things that you do in here. Yeah. And then you walk out and people are going to work and like coming home and like kids are running around and all that.
So. Yeah. Yeah. It's unassuming. And a lot of studios are that way, which is also a really cool thing.
Well, that's the joy of a studio. The best studio is the one you have no idea is there.
Right.
My brother owns one, up in Western New York, and it's been like, that is, I think the most important thing to him is that he makes great work out of there. And the second most important thing to him is that nobody knows it's there.
Sure.
I mean, no, if you drove by, you wouldn't know it was there.
Right.
For many reasons. But I always like it too, because then it's a space where you can kind of shut off. And like I said, not everyone gets to go to a studio all the time. Like people, I mean, you go to the studio every day and like your colleagues and your peers, you know, go to the studio all the time. But then you meet like that one band, they're just like, well, we make one record and this might be the only record we ever make in our lives. And so you're always trying to create an atmosphere where you're just like, cool, if this is the only one you're ever going to make, then like, let's make it.
Yeah. And I think every project needs to be approached that way, at least for me.
Yeah.
Like it has to be a special experience for them every time, because if I'm not working towards that end, what are we doing?
Yeah.
You know, one of my favorite things is when we get done for the day and someone says, oh, that was fun. I'm like, well, shouldn't it always be fun?
Yeah.
You know, but it's not. And I've heard horror stories of really bad studio experiences.
I have too. And at least for me, at a certain level, I guess if it's your living, then yeah, you're going to have good days and bad days. You're going to have days where you're getting it. You're going to have days where you're not getting it. And I think those good or bad days will come out of just like, you know, because you care so much. But then I think about people who like do this, like this is a hobby. I'm trying to like get away from the idea that the term hobby and music going together are like, is like a dirty word or something like that. I think it's incredibly rewarding hobby. I think it's better than playing golf. Certainly much less wasteful.
Right.
No shit anyone plays golf, whatever, do you think? But you know, I'd rather play guitar than play golf. But, but like people like that, like if it's bad, then get out.
Yeah.
Like, because as I've often said in bands I've walked away from, like projects I've walked away from, you probably too, just like if it starts to feel like work, I already got one of those.
Sure. Yeah. And it's a fine line because it can be hard and it can be not very rewarding, and it can often feel like we don't know where we're going with it.
Mm-hmm.
But it always, for me, it's always got to be fun, and it always is fun. And I'm super spoiled to work on stuff that I love all the time. But yeah, like, let's not lose sight of that. We are making music, and let's keep the good energy.
Yeah, I used to work with one guy who said, like, "Hey, come on, guys, we could have real jobs." And I'm just like, "That's true." Yeah, and that's something that I always like to create in the studio, the idea, even if it is people, you know, if it's, you know, if this is a weekend warrior type thing or whatever. When I've worked with people, and I know when I work with my brother too, he does the same thing where he's just like, "But this is summer camp. Like, this is, you know, the outside world doesn't exist, you know." He set up spaces, and you guys set up spaces here too, where there's like places to chill out and relax. And
yeah.
Like, and also it's useful for the engineers, because then not everyone's not just sitting in the control room the entire time.
it's really important. That was a huge thing for Rob when he was building the place, was like, a place to hang out. It's huge. And the funny thing is, like, the first record I brought here, I didn't intend for this, but it was also sort of what brought me to the space, was this Brazilian jazz record with a 15-piece big band and strings.
Is that Minas?
Yes.
Okay. I was trying to chase down some music on Minas on the major streaming services. I couldn't find it immediately. There's some rapper or singer with that same name and spelling. I just looked at the picture. I'm like, I'm pretty sure. I thought it was something like, this isn't a multi-piece Brazilian band.
No.
I don't even have to click play.
Right.
How did you hook up with this dude? Because you'd been around. You'd been at Range. You'd been... I used to record at Range back in the day.
Yeah.
I cannot remember the name of any of my engineers over there. But I always liked the room.
Yeah.
I liked how it felt kind of like a really big dome, and it had all the rooms on the outside, which I really dug, because I was always, when I wanted to record, I was like, how much of this can we do simultaneously?
Yeah,
was always my drive. But how'd you find your way here?
So it was looking for a space that could accommodate the scope of that record and what the production needed, and a really nice piano. And funny enough, I used to be neighbors with one of the guys who was like on the brain trust that helped build this studio.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, "I know the space for you, and I'll put in a good word," because this space has always been kind of under the radar, kind of friends and family. You have to know someone. And so I knew someone, and he introduced me, and we did that record here, and it was love at first sight for sure. And we did, like, definitely push the limits of what this room could handle in terms of people and isolation and everything. Yeah. And it was
a lot
like
of parts there too.
Oh yeah, huge. It was a huge, intricate project, and this room handled that. And it was like, well, if it can do that record, it could do anything that I would, anything else that I could think of bringing here.
Yeah, yeah. What are some of the early ones you remember doing here besides Minas?
It was mostly jazz, because for a long time this was the best jazz option as far as studios around for me, because of the Steinway, because of the sight lines and isolation. I did some records with Sumi Tanoka, the piano player. I still work with her sometimes. With her band currently is called Alchemy Sound Project. Those were the kind of the early records working here, and then it all kind of blurs together. But yeah, everything kind of built up from there.
Yeah, because I remember, I think you first came across my radar with the Right Fiction record.
Mm-hmm.
When I met Aaron, because I'd known Aaron from previous bands
that he had
been in, and then he came on the show. That might have been during pandemic time. We might not have even met in person at the time, but he was like listing out his guys in the band, and yours was a name I didn't know, because I knew who Freddie was, and
everybody knows Freddie.
You can't not know who Freddie is.
Yeah,
I'd never met him, but I knew who Freddie was, and I'm like, oh, I didn't know his name, but I remember listening to the parts and Aaron being like, oh yeah, and he's sort of like, he engineers the tracks too, and I remember listening to those Right Fiction tracks and being like, this is really solid and really unique. Like, there are a lot of different ways you can go with sort of the vibe of this particular project, and you had like a couple of bass runs in there that I was just like, all right, this guy is tasteful and on the edge. I'm like, I have to meet this guy at some point. Just, and it's so funny. I don't know if you get that when you hear people play or something like that, but you, in that moment, you're just like, I feel like I know a little something about this guy that maybe, like, you know, just by listening to how you played and like just sort of your treatment of Aaron's songs and all that.
Yeah.
And I really do love those recordings. I wish there were more of them.
Thanks. We are working on it for sure. And, you know, I got to say, I love making music with Aaron for so many reasons. And I've told him this before, but I think he was a bass player in a former life.
Yeah.
Because when we work on that stuff, he has such interesting suggestions for me and pushes me to try stuff that might not be like my first choice to do something. So yeah, he's a wonderful collaborator.
Yeah. And you've got a lot of choices too. Like you have a depth and breadth of experience there where you can pull from a lot of different things. And so for someone to still be pushing you, and a guy who probably doesn't consider himself, you know, a musician with a capital M, or like in fact, I remember when I talked to him, he says sometimes he felt like the most outclassed guy in the room, you know, with you and Freddie and whoever. And I was like, well, it's true. If I sat in a room with people like that too, I might feel a little less than. But as a guitar player, Aaron is really, really something. I think he's
got it going on, and he thinks that, and honestly, it's like his biggest asset. Because, and I'm not saying this to diminish him, but it's like that idea of beginner's mind.
Yeah.
There are no rules, because if you have some background and some training, then all of a sudden you feel like there's things you shouldn't do and things you should do. He doesn't have any of those boundaries. So everything is kind of fair game. If he has an idea that is interesting in his head, he'll be like, can we try this? And, you know, sometimes when we're working, I'm like, I don't think that's going to work. But that voice in my head, I'm learning to silence and just be like, you know what, why don't we try it? Because Aaron, like he has interesting stuff. I'm not saying that everything he suggests works, but he suggests stuff that like is so refreshing sometimes. And again, like not something that I might necessarily suggest. So it's an asset for him, and for him to, I would love for him to keep thinking that about himself. He's one of the best singers I've ever worked with.
Oh, fantastic singer.
I love his voice, his songs. He's great in that way. But yeah, I kind of hope he always thinks of himself that way, because that's what enables him to like be kind of fearless in the studio and in writing, because he'll try something that like on paper might not make any sense at all.
Yeah. And I know you work with like Dave Cope a lot too. And it's another guy too, that I'm just like, wow, what a unique, just fascinating human being.
Yeah.
And just as a musician and a writer, like every time I hear something new from him, I'm just like, well, how is this the best thing you've ever done? Like that doesn't seem, Dave, if you're listening, it doesn't seem fair.
Dave Cope can write you three songs before breakfast.
Yeah, it's just all of them good.
All of them good. I remember the last thing we were working on, I was mixing and mastering his last record. And one of the last sessions he wasn't here for, I was just kind of like doing, like incorporating some notes and some tweaks. And I remember calling him to get clarification on something. And he was like, oh yeah, this is a good time. I'm just working on this song. And then I called him an hour later with a follow-up question. He was like, oh, that song's done that I had mentioned.
Yeah.
Like he's incredible. And, you know, talk about somebody who pulls from so many different backgrounds and, you know, speaks so many musical languages.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Like just delving into like his knowledge of Eastern music as well was really, really fascinating to me. Like I didn't realize there's a couple of people who popped across my radar, him and Mike Brenner is another one too.
Oh yeah.
Where you're just like, aside from all the other things we know them for, you know, we know Dave is this like fun Beatles, Beach Boys, psychedelic pop guy. And you think of Brenner as like, you know, this absolutely just killer steel player. And then both of them have very, very different, unique takes on what they've gotten from studying Eastern music. My favorite thing about Brenner was that like, he never set out to master anything. He was just trying to take it in and have it inform, you know, like jam sessions, to the point that it actually like angered his, the person who was teaching him. It was like, no, I thought you were here to like truly take this on. And Mike was like, no, I'm just trying to check something out. Which you can imagine as someone like a master of a certain style of music, you could maybe see why they might, you know, take that a little hard, but I don't know. Like,
yeah, I hear that as curiosity, and I think that can never be a bad thing.
Yeah, regardless of how far in you go, I think, especially as we get older, the fact that we display any sort of curiosity towards anything is, I think it means we're still alive. Not physically, well, maybe physically too, but like, I think it means we're still alive.
Totally. Like, yeah, I mean, because what else is there to do?
Yeah.
You do the same thing all the time. Well, that's no fun. So remaining curious is, I think, is really helpful.
As Charlie Hall kept saying in his live show at Solo Myth, the joke amongst the band was, It's something to do.
It's something to do. Yeah, I love that. Yeah. I love Charlie, man. Oh, he's great.
I love Charlie. I love his hats.
Yeah. One of the best dressed dudes I've ever known.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. But did you work on Invisible Ink at all?
No, I did not. Yeah, I kind of met him, I think, when that was almost done.
Yeah. My God, that record's amazing.
Yeah.
And I was blessed to have it as a download for like many months before he put it out. And I was just always, I'd be just sitting around and be like, well, let me go downstairs to the studio just so I can put Charlie's records on my monitors.
Nice.
Yeah. I'd never seen him play guitar before. And he played all the guitars. He had like 7 guitars up there with him, and he played all of them. So I got to give him that.
Yeah. I mean, talk about a deep, you know, another deep person. Like he's got so much going on. He's pulling from so much, and just being in the room with him when he's doing his thing as a producer, which is not what he's known for primarily.
I think it's one of his strongest suits right there.
He's incredible at it.
I'll debate whether or not to take this out later, but I think the fact that he's the drummer in War on Drugs might be like one of the less interesting things about the man.
I have a friend who said the same thing.
Yeah, yes. and that is absolutely no shade on the band or not anything at all. Like that, but I'm just like, that's just like, and for anyone to just play like that and play at that level, like that would be the utmost aspiration. But for him, he's just, he's always chasing, he's always listening.
He's got so much music in him. Yeah, I was bummed. I missed the Invisible Ink shows, but I did get to see the Ghost Horizons show with Marshall Allen and Dan Hotel.
I missed that, and I was bummed I missed that. Marshall's one of those guys that I keep thinking in the back of my head. I'm like, I gotta get a mic in that guy's face like as soon as humanly possible.
I know, right?
I have no idea where we are.
Good.
It's okay. I did want to talk about Ron and the Hiptones real quick,
because
that was like a fascinating thing for me to come across. That came across my desk, and that Max sent me some stuff, and I normally don't read artist statements. Like I mean, I do, but I don't normally like delve into bios too much, but I just started reading Ron's story, and I was like, well, this is the most interesting thing that I've read in a while. I talked to Max, and then I went and interviewed Ron, and that's got to be one of the highlight interviews, I think, of me doing the show entirely.
Isn't he a sweetheart?
The way he tells this story, he could feel a lot of ways about how his life ended up or what happened to him. But like, I don't know, man. Like, I hope I approach life with even like 1/10 of just the graciousness that he approaches life. And he's still a great singer. Yeah. And you and Dave and all you guys like wrote really, really great songs for him to sing that don't feel dialed in. It doesn't feel like you guys are putting on a hat, you know. No offense, Charlie. not that kind of hat. But like, sometimes when people go in for a style, especially something as specific as like, you know, 1960s, 1970s, you know, soul and funk, particularly, you know, kind of Philly sound. I mean, like, we're in an area that like that's in the water still.
Yeah.
But you guys really came up with some very like some great songs that I thought about later. I was like, these could also work in so many other ways too. They work really well with Ron. I'm like, but this somewhat like I think it was Tear My Chin or something like that. I was like, you changed the rhythm on this. Like, this is almost a club banger right here. Or can be if you sped it up or something.
Yeah. No, and Max is very aware of that because he's in tune with like the breakbeat scene. Yeah. You know, he's constantly thinking in those terms. It's not like what we're necessarily striving for, but it's sort of like, you know, this would lend itself to something like that if someone were so inclined. Well, thank you. And I'm glad. And it's been such a rewarding project for me. I love that whole crew. It's been really great. And, you know, I want to finish up the record soon to get it out there. We've got a bunch of stuff out there, but not everything. It's interesting for me because on the engineering side of things, like you're saying, we're trying to recall a certain era. And as a side note, Max has brought in a couple of the original Sigma guys to help mix with me.
Oh, cool.
And that's been so amazing. Like, just what a learning experience from those guys who know that sound better than anyone and who know how to dial it in.
They invented it.
They invented it, exactly.
Yeah.
So that was super cool. But at the same time, it's sort of like we can't deny modern ears either. Yeah. And so trying to find that line of something that feels authentic to both worlds, something that's like, it's retro, it's modern, it's classic, but it's now. And it's a hard line to find.
certainly. And like many have tried and failed. And then some people, I think of someone like Bruno Mars who gets it very, very well, or even someone like in his heyday, like Prince, who is like able to kind of hit, Prince could still hit his old sound while still making it sound like he just made it up that day.
Yeah.
and I think about what some of the Ron and the Hiptones stuff is like, you listen to that stuff and you're just like, this could have been recorded in the 70s, except that my ears tell me, I'm like, well, no, it actually sounds better. Because, you know, we've great advances in technology and the ways we listen to stuff and the things that we can do now. And like going back to like we were talking about with tape, it's like, yeah, you could be a purist, but you could also just, you could look at what you have in front of you and say like, what is going to be the coolest? And let's just go do that.
Right. Totally. And try to be kind of ruthless about it, you know, and
yeah.
Not to be nerdy, but maybe for just a moment, like,
no, that's fine. This is why I'm here.
We have a real plate reverb here.
Oh, cool.
And we use it a lot. And particularly on that record, I've used it a ton, but not for every song. It's not always the winner. You know, sometimes the plugin is the winner. And I try not to stand on ceremony about that stuff. It's like, let's find what is the coolest sounding thing in this context and let's use that, whether it's the analog version that I'm touching or it's software. And it doesn't matter.
No, it is good to be, and I think some of the best engineers and producers that exist right now are pragmatists in that way, where it's just like, look, let's not discount the new colors, you know, just because they're new. Yeah, some of them might be stupid, but we're all professionals. So, like, we're going to figure out real quick whether or not this is going to work or not. But also not throwing it away because it didn't work once.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
My buddy Kyle from Headroom always says to me, he's like, even a crappy piece of gear does one thing really well, and one day you're going to figure out what that is.
Sure.
And I mean, I think that speaks to us going back into our heyday of like, you know, in punky bands with like bad pedals and crappy recording gear, but like even a four track cassette recorder, like there is something about it. There's something in the hiss. There's something in the band. There's something in the way that, you know, just cassette tape works that you're just like, nothing else sounds like this. And if you want it, like you said, there's guys making plugins that sound like them where I'm just like, you can just have that. It's not out of your reach.
Yeah.
Well, I suppose we should talk about Peace Fortress.
Oh, okay.
No, I really, really enjoy it. That's, I've had also sort of an Invisible Ink moment with that record as well. I also got it. I don't have it in order, so I've just been, I realized I got it alphabetically and like I couldn't figure out what the track order was. So actually when I'm listening to it, I just put it on shuffle intentionally. Cause I'm like, well, if I already don't have the order right now, why try and make order out of it right now?
Nice.
But, I've really been enjoying it. A lot of the kind of music that you're gravitating toward is stuff that I've really gotten into over the last 4 or 5 years. Like you mentioned Budos Ban in your one sheet, which I definitely hear, especially in those horns. The way they build too, like not necessarily even the voicings, but just like the way that you're building a track up from a groove and then like getting those horns. Because there's a couple of tunes on there with like when the horns are cooking, you're just like, oh, wow, how did we even get here? Was it always in your head that you wanted to make something like that or...
I don't think so. You know, it's sort of that line of having an idea of what you might want to do, but then letting it happen too, which I think is essentially what this project boils down to. Like the whole thing was, I love making records with people, but there was this tiny segment of music that didn't really fit anywhere else. It wasn't Right Fiction stuff. It wasn't Ron and Hiptone stuff. It wasn't anything else that I was a part of. And so I had these sketches I was kicking around and I called some players that I was really excited about getting together in a room. And I was like, well, here's some sketches. Like, why don't we start with this? And we played around with that and we just kind of jammed on it. And then from there, it's like you let great musicians do their thing. And I'm just, you know, I'm witnessing it pretty much. And so that was like the raw material. And I think by its nature, it had a lot of build quality to it. And so I took all of that raw material and I started to cut it up and make songs or compositions out of it, whatever you want to call it.
It's always tricky with instrumental too. I run into the same thing where, sketches is definitely what I have. Like I call them like skeletons sometimes.
Sure.
I've got A, I've got B, I've got an idea of a C and even a rough idea of how many times I want these things to happen. But then I run up against my own limitations as an instrumentalist. And especially like working out of my house. I mean, you have all this here, but in the end, if it's just you by yourself, you run up against that wall too, where you're like, there's only so many instruments I know how to play, and only so many of them I actually know how to play well. Do you play a lot of guitar on that record too?
I don't play any guitar.
Are you just all bass on that?
I play all bass, and there's a few keyboard moments, but I was like, I was pretty intentional about wanting to pretty much just play bass on it and let people come in and just exist in this world that I was trying to build and just be them.
Yeah.
And let them do that better than I could do it.
Sure, sure. Who did you have play guitar on a lot of this record?
So most of it, all of the tunes except for two, it's Will Brown.
Okay, so he did the studio. I've known Will for years.
Oh, great.
Will and I are bros.
Cool.
He's a fascinating human being. At times I have to remind myself how much younger he is than I than
you forget
is.
Yeah, same.
He is, I mean, to use that old cliche, it's old soul. Sorry, Will, we're gonna embarrass you. he tells me about this too. He's like, stop talking about me. I go, well, stop doing stuff,
right?
And then we'll stop talking about you. You even produced one of the six songs that I like the most, actually, was the one that you had worked on with him, or one.
Oh, nice.
Tacoma, I think it was. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that dude, and I love his approach to playing guitar. So, okay, I knew he was playing live with you. I didn't know that he was on the record. That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, most of the record, like 7 of the 9 tunes were cut in one night. And
oh,
so
really?
It was Will, it was Adrian Harpham on drums, mm-hmm. and then Logan Roth on keyboards.
Well, Logan, again, talk about another guy. I don't know Adrian well, or maybe I do.
You probably know his playing,
yeah.
If you don't know him. Yeah.
But Logan, talk about another guy where you're just like, holy crap. Like,
he's a wizard.
Yeah.
Bona fide.
I've enjoyed watching Logan as he gets older really dial in what it is he can do. Because when I first met him, it seemed like, okay, well, this kid can do literally anything. Him and Arjun. I was just like, they can do anything. It's been fun watching the two of them specialize at times.
Sure.
I think it's one of the joys of being an older musician amongst younger musicians is I get to watch the ones who are somewhat, who are 100 times better than me than I was at that age. And to watch them figure it out and like come to some conclusions that I'm like, I was 40 when I figured that out and you're 26. Good on you.
Yeah, keep going.
You got 14 years on me now. What else are you going to figure out? Like, no, it's great. It's great. I know some people might get threatened by that, but I'm just like, I have no skin in that game anymore.
Yeah. And it's not even that, you know, just like everyone's on their own doing their thing. But yes, I definitely get what you're saying.
Yeah. No, so that's awesome. Yeah. Will, yeah, such a unique guitar player. And like most of that record is like just big groove and build, and that's fantastic and I love it. And then you've got like that one outlier in the middle, which might actually be one of my favorite tracks on the whole record.
Cool.
The one called Impressionistic Thing.
Yeah.
That's the most film score-y one of it. So now that I know that you've done so much of that, like in your career, which I think I saw something where you had said like it was never an intention for you to really ever get involved in film scoring. I mean, outside of what you did with like when you were kids,
mm-hmm.
And that you just kind of found yourself doing it here and there.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's fun. I hadn't thought about that tune as like more of a cinematic thing, but now that you're saying that, I get what you're saying, and the strings help for sure.
Oh, sir. But the piano too, like the piano is really, I think, what drives that track right there. And it's, I mean, uniquely amongst the set of music, it's one of the only things without drums on it.
Yeah, pretty much. He might be doing some backgroundy stuff, but yeah, there's no
like, without like a major rhythm or groove, like,
totally
kind of locking it in.
Yeah, that was one of those, like, I have this crappy piano at home and I started messing around with that and I just couldn't stop playing. I just loved it, but I had no idea what I could do with it. And it's funny enough, like, I played it for Aaron and he loved it. And he was like, why don't we turn this into a Write Fiction song? I was like, I just don't hear it.
Yeah.
I don't hear how that can be a thing. But again, Aaron will find a way that I can't think of.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Maybe it will eventually. But that was one of those where like that night I was a little tentative to like show Logan to play anything at all, but
course,
I was like,
who wouldn't be?
Yeah, I was like, this is kind of what I was thinking, but like, please run with it. And
please don't laugh at me.
He starts warming up and I had an intern here who was running Pro Tools. So I just looked over, I was like, hit record right now. And so the tune actually, like, we started, that was there. Like, he was already playing for a bit and we just dropped in and started recording while he was figuring this thing out. That was one take.
Oh, cool.
We never did it again. It was like, okay, this is what it was. And then we ended up adding strings to it. My friend Brent, who's this incredible bass player, composer, arranger, and a great collaborator as well. And I just kind of conveyed to him some ideas that I had and he ran with that and we cut the strings to it and it just kind of became a thing.
It sits really nicely. Well, it sits really nicely in the record that I made for myself, of Order. And like I said, it's been shot at me in a different order every time I listen to it, which I also really enjoy. Because but by the time I realized I didn't have it right, I was just like, well, I'm not gonna bug him. Like, this is fine. Like, I just need to listen to the songs. Part of me in my head, I think, was just like, oh, it's instrumental music. What does it matter? And I was right. like, well, track order matters. But
yeah. Oh, that's fascinating. That's totally my bad for not sending you a track order.
No, it's, I could have done it's whenever you dump things into whatever they call iTunes now, mm-hmm. It's one of my pet peeves with like all files I get from anywhere is I'm just like, everyone, ID3 tag your stuff.
Yeah.
It's not hard.
Yeah.
The things I get that just show up as unknown, and then I have to go chase them down in the depths of the big list.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
And I know better too, and I didn't do that for you.
you had artist and you had tracks, which is more than I get from an album, and they all sat together in the same thing,
okay,
which
good.
Was nice.
All right.
They showed up alphabetically, and I was like, I'm pretty sure this isn't how we meant to do that.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm pretty sure the 2 1.5 minute songs are not meant to be next to each other, unless
right.
they are. I guess to kind of go out on this, though, like, now that you've done this, you've made this thing that it's like, it's you. Up to this point, you've always been part of groups. Your role changes in size depending on the group, but this one is all you. Are there any impressions you have now that you've done that to go forward with?
Yeah, I have just loved this whole process. I didn't think this was going to feel differently than any other record that I've made, honestly. And
I find that fascinatingly naive of you.
Totally.
Like, how did you not think it was your stuff? Like,
right. I don't know. It's maybe, I don't know. I mean, we could take a deep dive into that. I don't think we have time for that. But for some reason, that's what I thought. And so as things started coming together and I would tell people, you know, I was like super quiet about this at first. Like, I cut those tracks and then I didn't do anything with them for almost a year.
Oh, okay.
I just couldn't. Part of it was like, we had a daughter and that was my focus. But then I was also, part of it was like, I was terrified to listen to it, that it wasn't any good. And so then I slowly started to listen to it. And then once I started adding stuff and making things, and I was like, maybe I'm going to start telling people that this exists. And so I would start to tell some close friends, and then my close friends would be like, okay, they were like really interested in hearing about it. And then I would tell other people. And then as it came together, and the more people I talked to about it, people seem to be like, oh, cool, you're doing that. And again, like, how is this different from any other record I've made? But it just is. And it's really exciting for me to be doing this and to have a thing that is mine that's going out there.
And you're going to go on stage and you're going to play it with the guys. And that's something, I mean, have you ever done that? Have you ever fronted a project before?
I have never fronted a project, no. And they were all available, all the same core band was available, which is amazing. I mean, this was like...
Especially for Logan.
I mean, that guy is everywhere.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. I mean, this was like such a just wish list of people for me, and they all agreed to do it, which is just incredible. I can't believe it.
Yeah, no, it's going to be great. Like, and Falls is a cool room for it too, because it's kind of in the round and everything like that. And you get to, that'll be a good vibe right there.
Yeah, really good people over there. They've been awesome to work with. And yeah, I feel like it's a good spot for doing it.
Well, the record comes out when? It's the July...
July 18th.
July 18th, and then the show's the 20th.
Show's the 18th.
Show's the 18th.
Yeah.
That's convenient. You might as well just get it all over with it at once.
Everything drops, yeah.
Is this kind of a one and done, or are you already like, are there things in the back of your head now that you know you can do it?
Yeah.
And that it's good.
Yes. I want to do it again.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. I've already got ideas turning around in my head of the next thing, you know, and I am really lucky to work at an awesome facility where I can do some stuff here and there when I'm not working on other things. And yeah, I want to do it again. This was really fun.
Cool. Well, I'm glad. Like I said, I really, really did enjoy the record.
Thanks, man.
Well, this is great, man. Thanks for having me here and showing me the place and doing the thing, man. It was really great to meet and talk to you finally.
Yeah, you too. And thank you for doing the show. Like, honestly, it's so cool. Like, I've learned so much about musicians in Philly that I know of but don't know. And you're doing such a cool thing for the scene. So.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Who did you listen to recently that you thought was cool?
I listened to, Liza, I kind of know a little bit. And then the guy from Cosmic Guilt,
James.
Like, I sort of knew him, but I didn't know much about his process or that whole thing. That
have
was
you
really
listened
cool.
to that record?
Oh yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
That's another one that I got to wander around with well before that came out.
Nice.
Those are, and not just him, but George also writes, like, as George always jokes, he's like, I guess I write the title track of every record, but like the title track from that record is one of my favorite songs on that record. That whole middle section of that record is just like, I think that's the real meat. And I just love, there's something about seeing 10 people on stage just all do their thing.
Oh my gosh. When it's all working, I just went to see, so I'm friends with Stereo League and I've done some stuff with them.
I've known Mitch for a long time.
Oh sure. Yeah. Mitch is a friend. They just did a show at JB's not too long ago. I don't think they had 10, but it was up there.
Yeah, they have like 7 or 8 people on stage.
And it keeps growing. And when everyone just knows what they're supposed to be doing within that machine, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's so cool. No one's stepping on toes and everyone is just like lifting the whole thing up.
Yeah, yeah. It requires a real, it's both an amount of discipline, but then also an amount of just kind of letting it happen at the same time.
Totally.
Which if you could ever come up with a formula for that, then you know, you'd be off to the races. But thankfully nobody can.
Yeah, we keep chasing it.
Yeah, absolutely. Dude, thank you so much.
Thank you. Yep. It's been fun.
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Brendan McGeehan, for letting me come over and talk. It was great. Great conversation. Really, really enjoyed my time with him. Go to brendanmcgeehan.com for all your information about the man. And, of course, check out the Peace Fortress record. It's called New Moon. It's out July 18th. And if you're around and you're hearing this in time, July 18th, 7:30 p.m., Falzer Club. Go see the record release show for Peace Fortress with his live band, Will Brown, Logan Roth, and Adrian Harpham, featuring also Slowing the Boats and the SMC Quintet on that bill as well. Going to be a great night, July 18th. Like I said, go to the show notes for ticket information or go to falzerclub.com up there at 3721 Midville Avenue. Yes. Going to leave you with a track from the Peace Fortress LP New Moon. This is one of my favorites. This one's called Foomp, like F-O-O-M-P, Foomp. And you heard in the conversation, I talked about how I had the record alphabetically instead of in quote-unquote track order, and so I listened to it on random. But Foomp was the first song I would listen to every time because that's how I would start the shuffle. I really do enjoy this track. So yes, do all that. Check out music from Peace Fortress. Go to the show if you can. Check out all the work that Brendan's done over the years. There's a lot of it, and it's all very, very impressive. And that's going to do it for this week. This is 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. My name is Dan Drago. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Enjoy this track, Foomp, from Peace Fortress. Catch you next time.